pursue that, it's gonna come up, that fits both.
Yeah, I think that is kind of captured in the purpose idea, being able to identify the purpose of the requirement, and you have to identify who was being benefited.
That one seems to encompass a lot of things that are already in there. For example, the requirement that posts a burden on the developer might be that the high growth could notice how far they go.
Yeah, I sort of, I look at these, again, I look at these two as providing guidance to us to make sure we're thinking about these things as we're discussing the specifics of the requirements. That, you know, if there's a requirement that nobody around the table can, thinks, you know, can identify a clear benefit, then we should be asking ourselves, why are we going down this path? Or if we're talking about a requirement that nobody around this table can really identify the purpose of it, we should be asking ourselves, why are we going down this path? And I think it, again, just the guiding principles are, there are a lot of issues that are gonna come before us. If we just sort of keep that in mind and ask ourselves that and are clear about what it is, I think it helps us get to the definition, I mean, get to the requirement and a consensus around the requirement.
So let's see, the next couple, I stated earlier, establishing clear channels of communication between the developer and participating and non-participating landowners, and providing a free flow of information from the developer owner to the community and the political subdivision.
Are you thinking post-construction?
I guess I was thinking all, any time that might be addressed by the rules, whether it be pre-construction, during construction, or post-construction.
Okay. Including decommissioning?
Including decommissioning, potentially, yeah.
So, clear and timely, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Go for one item up, it's really more philosophical than, because I think it's any particular burden. It seems when you start to mandate communication between two people who have a commercial relationship, meaning you're participating landowners, kind of investing your time in an area that there's already a relationship there. I don't think you need to regulate the developer on how they communicate with the people they have a contractual arrangement with already.
That's good.
So are you suggesting that the during and after, that
I just
the during and after? Or?
I just strike participating.
Okay.
I just sometimes see rules where, to me, they kind of step back and go, it seems like you're trying to regulate two independent parties that came to an arrangement on how they're gonna do business together. And putting a easement at least will have a whole range of, it's like restoration. I sometimes see restoration, not in public right-of-ways or such areas, but on private property. Our agreements all have it. It isn't necessarily cumbersome. It just always strikes me as a little odd that we make an arrangement to do work on your property and the state's saying what exactly how I have to manage your property.
Yeah. Well, the state does that for an electrician when they come on your property. They regulate how that electrician's gonna do business and inspect it. And they do that because the consumer is at a disadvantage. I mean, we'll come back to talk about, you know, how we implement this, but I think there is a rationale.
I'm not familiar with the electrician. I would ask the question, quite frankly, the same on that same point. It assumes the weakness of the individual landowner to negotiate a proof of arrangement.
Mm-hmm.
And
yes,
that's rather presumptuous. Because
could we, you're making the point that it's possible we could come up with some requirements that in fact the landowner doesn't want.
Correct.
Doug's point is, how does the landowner know what all of their rights are in this, and, you know, sort of the universe of things that are eligible for discussion. Your point is, why would we start imposing things that the landowner doesn't want, may not only not want, but oppose? So it's sort of, how do you reach a sort of common sense on that approach?
But I'm not free to tell my electrician to do it the way I want. The electrician's required by code.
Right, but what you're talking about is a health and safety code about how an electrician does their job. Not the electrician comes in and as a result of it has to tear up your lawn, and how they're going to restore the lawn.
In this case, the code doesn't talk for that. Does it?
Right. And what we're really talking about here is...
But he was arguing, Andy was arguing on a principle, and I'm responding in terms of that principle. And rather than the particulars.
You're right. And I was thinking, not the health and safety issues, like OSHA regulates right. Everyone on our property healthy. So I was thinking more than
restoration.
Restoration. I mean, I'm more than happy to address anything as it comes in a particular item.
I'm not worried about aesthetics.
Go ahead.
As I listen to Doug and Andy here, I just wonder if this should be something in a lease agreement that we standardize.
Are you going to regulate how we write a lease agreement?
Well, let me just, can I just say, I mean, I think there was a mention of it on the outline that you all reviewed at the last meeting, that the rules may address what types of things would be in a lease or would not be in a lease. That was part of the outline. So I guess there wasn't anything that I could think of about that topic to put on as a guiding principle, but I think that is something that we will discuss later.
Definitely.
Did I interrupt anyone else? Sorry.
So I think we were talking about communications, is that correct?
Yes.
I would like to add in that you know, I guess the challenge that we face is not a question of whether or not we should communicate. Obviously, we should. The challenge is not, you know, it does become a bit of a challenge as to how far reaching that communication needs to go. And, you know, that's a separate discussion I expect we're going to get to later. The thing where I'm most concerned is that as we approach this, we have an intent of some, at this point, undefined level of communication that is going to occur. And what I fear is that later on, something else comes up that wasn't contemplated, wasn't anticipated, whatever, and all of a sudden I forgot to communicate that we're going to show up for work today in class just like we do every other day, and somebody decides, well, I'm in default. You know, and I realize I'm being absurd with what I'm saying, but what I'm hearing is that just as we see in so many other areas of society where things get litigated, that very often the original intent is stretched to an extreme. And so I will be careful, not a little bit, I'm very careful about what accepting as reasonable. That's not going to get extended. Really not the way I would contemplate it in the first place. And so I guess I'd ask you to keep that in mind as we approach this topic.
Yeah, and as we're going through this list and I'm listening to this conversation in the back and forth, I think if we can focus on providing the opportunity for, and whether we're talking about communication or what notice goes in or any of these issues, I think if we can try not to be too prescriptive.